Hello, I'm Stefan Farou, and I'd like to explain to you how Oracle stores data, physical implementation. When you issue a create table or create index command, you can add a clause that says table space, followed by a name that designates the physical location for the data. There is always a table space associated by default to a user account. If you are allowed to create a table and don't specify any table space clause when doing so, the data goes to your default table space. A table space is nothing more than a name given to a collection of database files. A file can belong to only one table space. If you add a new file to the table space, you expand it. You can also allocate more space to an existing file. When you create an Oracle database, some table spaces are automatically created. There are system and sysoaks, which store metadata internally used by Oracle. There are also two technical table spaces, one used for temporary storage, such as storage that is required on disk for performing a big sort that cannot hold in memory, and the table space for undo, which contains during a transaction the previous value of whatever you change in the database, so that you can roll your modifications back and restore a previous consistent state of the data if something unexpected goes wrong. Then you have table spaces where your application data is stored. It makes sense to completely separate the storage of transient data, such as undo or temporary storage, from permanent application data. It has long been advised to separate tables from indexes for performance reasons. The performance argument is completely bogus with modern storage systems. Nevertheless, most database administrators are very keen on having separate table spaces for tables and for indexes for manageability reasons. Now, when you are allowed to create a table in a table space, Oracle allocates a chunk of contiguous storage within one of the files of the table space, and you have no control over which one. The size of the chunk can be specified at table creation or is derived from defaults set for the table space. Note that contiguous storage is a view of the mind. It looks contiguous, but it is probably a very different story at the most physical level. As you insert data, the chunk fills in. When it's full, Oracle automatically allocates another chunk to the same table and fills it, and so on. The chunk is taken wherever there is room in the table space. It may be in the same file as the initial one, or in another, it doesn't matter. Each chunk, which in Oracle speak is called an extent, is contained within one file. However, the segment, which is the name given to the physical data store associated to a table or an index, can span several files, all belonging to the same table space. Oracle used to record in one dictionary table block and length of each allocated chunk, the used extents, and in another dictionary table, the starting block and length of each whole, the free extents. When space was allocated to a table, Oracle was looking for a whole big enough, created a new used extent, deleted the free extent or just its size, and when a table was dropped, the reverse operation was taking place. A table space that uses these mechanisms is known as a dictionary managed table space. When you have many concurrent processes inserting data, the allocation process may become a serious bottleneck because allocation operations must be serialized. This is why Oracle has introduced a new, now preferred, way to manage space that no longer involves the data dictionary, but uses instead bitmaps at the beginning of each file to track the allocation of blocks. A table space that uses file bitmaps is said to be locally managed, and that's the way it should go. Generally speaking, a table or an index is physically stored within one table space. There are nevertheless some cases when this isn't true. For instance, when a table is partitioned, it's the physical association of several sub-tables called partitions that can each reside in its own table space. A partition table can therefore span several table spaces. When a table contains large objects or lobs, they can be stored with the remainder of the table data if they aren't too large. If they are really large, rows contain pointers to the actual lob data that often resides in a different table space. The unitary, contiguous chunk or extent isn't the smallest storage unit handled by Oracle. Actually, each extent is comprised of a number of blocks, the size of which may vary. Common values are 8, 16 or 32 Ks. The block is for Oracle the smallest addressable unit. If Oracle needs to execute a query one byte from a block, the whole block will have to be brought into physical memory. An Oracle block contains a header that contains internal data, including information about transactions currently ongoing inside a block. The header is followed by a kind of directory that points to the first column of each row stored in the block. Data proper is stored from the opposite end of the block, row after row, and grows towards the directory. When you insert data, you insert up to a limit, and what stays above the data is defined as a percentage of available space called PCT-free. Since strings and numbers are stored with Oracle in variable format, updates usually change the amount of storage that is used by a row. This free space is kept as elbow room for updates. When a row is deleted, it is most often logically deleted. The actual byte shuffling may be done later, possibly by a select statement. When you delete rows, you may also cross another threshold, known as PCT used. The idea is that if the level of data goes below PCT used for a block that was previously filled up to the PCT free level, then it's time to insert rows again so as not to waste storage. The block that was marked as full is now marked as ready to take more rows. You can never predict where a row will go with a regular tuple. You can set those thresholds or subcontract everything to Oracle with a feature called Auto Segment Store Management, or ASSM. After a while, the blocks in your extents will contain a variable number of rows. The first block of the first extent is reserved for internal information, such as the high water mark, a pointer to the last block in which data was ever stored. This information is important when performing a full scan, because there is no point scanning empty blocks above the high water mark. Oracle can also, in some insertion modes, insert new rows above the high water mark, which is faster than looking for gaps to fill. Now the interesting question, what can go wrong? There are two patterns, the nuclear apocalypse and the insidious cracks that build over time and degrade performance. Armageddon occurs when in the middle of a process space is required and not found, and this statement fails, preferably in the middle of the night, with an error. The solution is easy, increasing the tuple space size, and problems can often be avoided by monitoring. Files can also be put in auto-extent mode, but a full file system isn't an outcome that is much more desirable than a full tuple space, and auto-extension is better reserved for some special operations, such as software upgrades. A normally sized temporary tuple space running out of storage in the middle of a query is usually a problem with a query going nuts and taking the wrong plan. Checking statistics and, if need be, rewriting the query is more likely to solve the problem once and for all than adding more space in the hope that it will be enough. In a way, the cracks may be more difficult to deal with because the proper solution requires a good understanding of what is going on. First, ignore the number of extents. That is a big thing for some people. If you are using disk arrays, your data is already sliced and diced anyway, and nobody cares about fragmentation. Real problems occur inside extents. If there are many deletions and if the threshold for inserting data again is set too low, after a while you will get a low data density in your blocks. It can be a good thing if it reduces contention between competing processes that will no longer access the same blocks. It is more likely that it will degrade performance, because to return the same amount of data, you will have to bring into memory and scan a much higher number of blocks. A potentially very damaging problem is when row updates make rows grow past the amount of storage set aside for them. Then, either full rows have to be moved elsewhere, or part of the row is stored in an overflow area. The problem comes from the fact that indexes still point to the original location, which in turn points elsewhere. That very seriously degrades the performance of searches. If you want to avoid this, blocks must be designed from the start to store few rows, so as to allow for future updates. Another common issue happens when a tuple that is used as a communication medium between a producer and a consumer process fills up after a temporary failure of the consumer process. It bumps up the high water mark, and since those tuples are usually scanned, consumer processes are slowed down long after the backlog has been cleared. There are several ways to reset high water marks, such as truncate to empty the tuple, or altering it with move to rebuild it, or the more recent, shrink. In any case, reorganizing data isn't something that you can contemplate on a routine basis. It's very disruptive, and whenever it brings some improvement, which isn't always the case, it can only be a temporary reprieve. You should aim for a self-organizing database, which requires understanding how data is stored and what can go wrong with your processes. Thank you for your attention.